Brave New World, Inside Pochettino's Spurs, by Guillem Balague. Read by Piers Hampton.
Forward, by Karina Gripaldi. I'm overjoyed to be writing the foreword to this book about Mauricio Pochettino, his life and his number one passion, football. We met on a night out when I was a student at the National University of Rosario, and he was celebrating a Clásico win, when Newell's beat Central. It was a fabulous evening. Since then, we've been down all the paths that football has taken us on together, and our lives certainly revolve around the beautiful game. We've had many years filled with marvellous experiences, and others that haven't been quite so wonderful. But we've certainly learned from all of them. We've created a united family, and we all support one another. We're far from our loved ones back in Argentina, but we're lucky to have fantastic friends. As a family, we all have our own individual dreams, but we adapt and support each other, trusting in one another's decisions. He is certainly the leader of the family, and the one whose strength has taken us on so many adventures. Mauricio is incredibly sensitive. He's a people person who likes hearing stories and listening, thanks to his pleasant and positive disposition. He enjoys spending time with friends and family and making the most of the little free time at home that he has to play football, tennis or ping pong with our two boys, do some gym work with me, or simply watch a film while having some mate, our loyal hot drinking companion. We enjoy our garden or the local green spaces by going on a walk through the park whenever possible. Such moments help him relax, switch off and recharge his batteries for what lies ahead. He spends almost all his time at the training ground, where I regularly visit him to deal with little family issues, and just to see him for a bit, however briefly it may be. I think we form a strong team. I like seeing myself as the guardian of our intimacy. It all helps build a balance in our lives and daily existence. Experience tells us that there are no straight lines in football. You can go from glory to criticism, being ignored or slated in an instant. So between us, we try to maintain the right distance and equilibrium to accept and enjoy our place in the world. I very much doubt that I've ever given him advice that has helped him do his job. I think Mauricio has exactly what it takes to do what he does. He's like the ocean, in that he's plentiful and strong. He flattens all that lies before him, and he is relentless. The wise water covers everything in its way, always finds gaps, and embarks on new paths. He isn't scared, and sees every opportunity as a challenge. That's his essence. He sees life as an adventure worth exploring, and his motto is tranquilidad, calmness. I, on the other hand, am rainwater. I like to nourish, organize, lay the foundations, and seek out stability so that my house is a paradise, where you can recharge your batteries and come up with and develop new ideas. That's how we complement one another. Introduction. All of literature, Leo Tolstoy pointed out, comes down to one of two stories. A man goes on a journey, or a stranger comes to town. What you hold now comprises both of those two things. First, it recounts a journey, that of the 2016-17 season, Pochettino's third at Spurs. But it is also the story of someone who has been a stranger since he left his home in Murphy as a teenage boy. This is and isn't a diary of Mauricio's campaign. Allow me to explain. It is a kind of collage. His words, his thoughts, his experiences are in here. Some were said by him in the conversations we had on an almost weekly basis. Others were told to me by the people around him to fill in some gaps. Players that he has coached in the past, or that he coaches now, explained private moments, crucial tactical chats, reasons for hugs. Professional colleagues recollected memories of times past. Friends did the same. Travelling companions uncovered little secrets. And big ones. Eventually their words have become Pochettino's words, channeled through me and always reviewed, although never censored, by the man himself to ensure they reflected his thoughts and actions. This diary, that both is and isn't a diary, is something of a literary trick that hopes to give readers a better insight into his ideas and methods, as I have gained over the course of a remarkable season. Sometimes Pochettino did not recognize his voice, feeling that in written form his thoughts sounded too brusque. At others, he was surprised by how deeply he had explored his shortcomings, learning process, and journey. But the rule was not to look back months later and change the predominant feeling at the time. Eventually, we agreed that what came out was unusual, a biography in the first person. But that it best explains this particular moment in his career and life. My chats with him were very regular, and the transcriptions have filled hundreds of pages, but they were not weekly, as originally planned, because at times he distanced himself. Like tides that ebb and flow, so Mauricio could be hard to pin down. There were many reasons for his sudden absences, which you will discover later. At such moments, his assistant, Jesus Perez, took on a key role by telling me how the week was going, what it was like in training, and how they negotiated any obstacles on and off the pitch. Miguel D'Agostino, the member of the coaching staff who had known Mauricio for the longest, sent me audio files from his car en route to training, with stories from Rosario, Barcelona, France, Southampton, and London. We sometimes sat down with Tony Jimenez for a chat. Karina, his wife, did a key job as quartermaster, searching through photos and adding essential detail. So, let us start by hearing where he stood at the start of the 2016-17 season, and soon after how the life of Mauricio the Stranger has developed since his early days in the fields of Murphy, a village where nothing ever happened, but where parameters were set that have stayed with him ever since. He will, at the same time, embark with us on the journey through the season in the form of a diary that is real, but is also not real, even though everything is true. Chapter 1. Summer and Pre-Season. Tottenham Hotspur came third in 2015-16, a remarkable achievement for a club that has to operate without the hefty budgets available to Arsenal, Chelsea, Liverpool, Manchester City, and Manchester United. The final league match of the campaign, however, a 5-1 thrashing at the hands of already relegated Newcastle, left a bad taste in the mouth of Mauricio Pochettino and his coaching staff. The target for the upcoming season was crystal clear: improvement. The coach and most members of the squad were gearing up for their Champions League debut and Tottenham's second foray into Europe's premier club competition after a 5-year absence. While making plans for the new journey, Pochettino could still hear the roars from a rocking St. James Park home faithful, celebrating the championship-bound side's assortment of goals. Why did we start our holidays before that match? What did we do wrong? That uncomfortable place is where we are at the moment. It was all my fault. I did something wrong. We have to understand the underlying cause behind that defeat. I got the screen out at half time when we were 2-0 down. But it wasn't a matter of altering the position of our defensive line or which players played where. What's happening here has nothing to do with tactics. We aren't battling. You aren't yourselves on the pitch. I repeated that several times. But it was to no avail. Where was the individual commitment that gave us that special feeling of belonging to the group? I get very annoyed when I cannot find the way to motivate, to generate the passion necessary to enjoy this game. Was it my fault? At the end of the game, I headed into an empty dressing room. The players gradually came in, but I swiftly had to head off to see to my media commitments with radio and television. I came back 45 minutes later, by which point they had all showered and got changed, so I couldn't say anything. What was I to do? We went back down to London together, but there was no way to get the players on their own. I didn't even try. Everyone had serious expressions on their faces. They certainly all had their own ideas in their heads and had reached their own conclusions. We were not avoiding one another, but nobody was smiling. We felt embarrassed when we crossed paths, and if we saw a fan, we kept our heads down. Players want first and foremost to win, of course, because they're the ones who are on the pitch and there's nowhere to hide. But sometimes they live in their own reality. Without realizing it, they become trapped in a bubble. A player's entourage protects him and often blocks out other worlds out there, only allowing him to see his own. Of course, a footballer must look after himself and put up walls in order to ensure that external factors don't have an overbearing impact. But in order to perform well, he needs a balance of self-esteem, ego, his own reality, and other realities outside those walls. Excessive self-criticism is crushing, as is ignorance of the wider world. It becomes a serious matter when there's a mental disconnect with the basic principles of the game. If the footballer's aim isn't a shared one, but purely individual, and he forgets the required order in this sport, that the individual shines more when at the surface of the team and the structure that supports him. I was thinking about all of that as we landed back in London from Newcastle. I got in the car and headed home. The first thing that I did when I got there was open a bottle of wine and stuff myself with unhealthy food. I think I let my frustration out on myself. I ate the lot. Crisps, snacks. If we had pizza, some of that as well. No salad. The wine was Argentinian, a Malbec. Whenever I am slightly down, I like to smell Argentinian wine. It makes me happy and takes me back to my country, to recognizable places. To when I was a boy, the redolence of the countryside where I lived until the age of 8, in that house with an orchard and horses. If I am challenged to some blind wine tasting, I quickly suss out which one is Argentinian, particularly Malbec. Today, I started this diary. Not even 24 hours have passed since the game. I've just received a message from Harry Kane saying thank you for the season and that it was a good year despite the final match. You could see that he felt ashamed at the end of the game. I'm not going to reply. He doesn't expect it either. I've started the summer in Qatar. I received an invitation from one of the directors at Aspetar Hospital in Doha, Dr. Hakim Chalabi, a good friend of mine, who was my doctor at Paris Saint-Germain. It's a 3-day trip with Jesus Perez, my assistant and right-hand man, and my son Sebastiano, who specializes in sports science. We've had a great time, and they've explained to us how they're preparing for the World Cup in Qatar. Everybody was impressed by our campaign. There was talk that we'd played the best football, had the most shots on goal, conceded the fewest goals and the rest. But I couldn't brush off the embarrassment of what had happened on the final day. I'm experiencing another type of deeper pain. My father-in-law is unwell. He went to Barcelona to continue his treatment, and when we saw him, my wife Karina and I could tell that he wasn't right. He wasn't the same person whom we knew and had enjoyed spending time with 2 years ago, the last time we saw him. I've just sent good luck messages to the players at Euro 2016, which has just kicked off. While I was writing to them, I thought about how at Newcastle we had stopped doing what we'd been practicing for 2 years. Finishing third is certainly not the same as finishing second, even though some seem to think it is. Arsenal leapfrogged us in the end. I didn't recognise my own team. I should have seen it coming. I should have sensed that some of them were already on holiday, and others were thinking about the Euros. In reality, we did sense it, and we did see it. I should have stopped that negative spiral, but how? Sending them good luck messages hurts. I'll do it before every game, but it hurts. How can anyone think that finishing third is the same as finishing second? You learn from everything. I played football and volleyball between the ages of 8 and 10. I liked football the most, but lots of girls played volleyball, so we'd play in an indoor gym, and when we went to local villages, the girls would come with us for their own matches. I really loved playing volleyball, especially in away games. I also did judo. The teacher was a strong Japanese man with a very dark character. His son was a year older than me, strong from practicing martial arts almost from birth, and also the goalkeeper of a rival team that I came up against during a tournament in Murphy. I was our best player. I went up for a corner and started to position myself to receive the ball, which was delivered with real venom. I began to jump, and what ensued left its mark on me forever. That son of a goalkeeper came up to me and pulled my shorts down to try to put me off. Imagine the fans and the parents. I was 10 years old. It pissed me off so much. I cried and cried, because I felt so powerless on the pitch. Everyone was looking at me, people who were there and people who weren't, the whole world. Or that is how it felt. It was the most humiliating moment of my life. The most insufferable part was the fact that I didn't have the balls to react. I should have grabbed him by the neck and punched his lights out. Of course, it was a lesson. It's useful for when someone beats you in a game, gets the better of you in a duel, or you get nutmegged. It makes you fight against your destiny and gives you strength. You retrieve energy from places you thought previously empty. That helped me be even stronger, braver, and more passionate. The next time that something like that happened, I gave the guy a punch. That was in the Argentinian First Division. We were playing San Lorenzo, and Francisco Oscar Lamolina was the referee. One of the opposition strikers tackled me from behind. I just stood my ground, and he shoved his head in my face. He insulted me, and I certainly didn't hold back. I could see him working the saliva. He spat at me, and his gob went into my mouth. Of course, at that moment of indignation, I went to clobber him. As I was approaching his face, I was regretting it. In the end, I only made a light connection, so the referee, who could see that I was sorry and what the guy had done, said to me, "You idiot. What the hell are you doing? I'm going to bloody send you off. Actually, I'm not going to, because I saw what the other guy did, and I'd have to send you both off." Both of us stayed on the pitch. That is how it often works in the First Division in Argentina. What a wonderful decision. Lamolina later told me that he would have done the same. I don't know exactly why I'm writing all this, nor the reason behind the order, or lack thereof, in which I tell the stories. I don't know what to talk about, or if it's suitable for a diary. Maybe it's a good time to reflect on where I come from and try to piece together the puzzle of what I've been and what I am. If that's the aim, I imagine I should start from the start. It's a good time to begin this because I've suddenly found myself with time on my hands that I wasn't expecting. We went on a family holiday to the Bahamas for a week, but it rained every single day. What was supposed to be a week of sunbathing turned into anything but. I watched football while we were waiting for the weather to clear up. It was my saviour. I was in a lovely house, and the television had cable, meaning every game in the Euros and Copa America was broadcast live. Football comforted me. My wife was rather irritated, of course. My sons were delighted to watch it with me. 3-1. Not much of a balance. We ended up cutting short our trip to the Bahamas. We'd have come back sooner, but I couldn't find any flights. So we made a swift return to London and then headed to Barcelona to enjoy a week of sunbathing by the pool at our family apartment. And all the while, I've been making notes and filling up blank pages between flights, rain, matches, and breaks. In particular, I've been thinking about Murphy and Newell's, where I made my first steps in football. But before that, I need to go back to my bedroom at my parents' house when I was a teenager. I was asleep when negotiations for my transfer to Newell's Old Boys began in the early hours. There were two boys from Murphy, 3 or 4 years older than me, who played for Rosario Central. One of them, David Bisconti, went on to play in the First Division and for the national team. The guys wanted me to join them at Central. One day I trained with them, and the club wanted to sign me straight away, but I was 13 and still finishing the academic year in Murphy, the town in Santa Fe, where I was born, some 160 kilometers from Rosario. I couldn't sign until the end of the school year in December or January, so they suggested I went to training with them once or twice a week while I still played in Murphy. Dele Alli did a similar thing when we signed him. He trained with us, but played for League One outfit MK Dons, where he came from. In my case, I was in a team that were 3 or 4 years older than me, but held my own well. I thought I would end up at Central. This is how the days went. I studied agriculture at a local school around 20 kilometres from my house. I would wake up at 6 a.m. to get the bus, and around 5 p.m. after I finished school, I would embark on the 3-hour journey to Rosario. Sometimes my dad would take me, but mostly I went on the bus, spending those 3 hours sleeping or talking to people. That journey used to get on my nerves, as the bus stopped everywhere, just like the milkman. I eventually had to change schools to one where I only had to go in the morning and did not have to rush to go to training. When I got to the facilities at Rosario Central, I would train and then spend the night at their digs. I would work again in the morning and then go home. At the weekend, I played in my hometown on Saturdays and Sundays. It all started again on Mondays. On one of those Mondays, Marcelo Bielsa and Jorge Grifo from Newell's Old Boys, Central City rivals, set up a trial for a group of players at Villa Cañas, a town around 50 kilometres from Murphy. There was a coach in Villa Cañas who knew me and was aware I was a good player, so he asked my father to take me. On that trial day, I left school and got to Murphy around 6 p.m. I was exhausted after a long day at school and having played at the weekend. I didn't fancy going. I told my father, and he told me not to worry, so we didn't go to the trial. At breakfast on Tuesday morning, my father told me what had happened the previous night. It turns out that after the trial, Bielsa and Grifa, who were travelling all over the country in search of fledgling talent, were having a hearty meal with the coach who knew me, and they asked him if there were any other interesting prospects in the area. He replied, "Yes, the best of the lot didn't come, because he's at Central." They looked at each other as if to say, "No way." "Where does he live?" they asked. And they set off to meet me. It was 1 o'clock in the morning in the middle of winter. They reached the service station in Murphy and asked the very few passers-by around at that time of night until they found the house. They knocked on the door and my mother got up. They told her who they were, but she refused to open up, opting to fetch my father instead. She woke him up, and because he had heard about them, he invited them in for a coffee. Bielsa later told me that after chatting for 5 or 10 minutes and explaining why they were there, they didn't know what to say or talk about, so they decided to ask my father, "Could we see the boy?" Despite the early hour, my proud parents said yes, and they came to my bedroom to take a look. They saw me sleeping, and Grifa asked, "May I see his legs?" My mother pulled the covers off me, and they both said, "He looks like a footballer. Look at those legs." Of course, what were they going to say to my parents? Although my small bedroom was full of people admiring my legs, I slept like a log and had no idea about it until my old man spilled the beans the following morning. From that point, they started calling my father to convince him to take me to training. I didn't want to go. I was happy at Central. My grandfather, who had a friend who had played for Nours, was the one who convinced me. So I went to meet Bielsa and Grifa. I travelled by bus, because my father was busy working the land. Again, it took me 3 nervous hours to get to Rosario. Some club representatives were waiting for me at the station, and they took me to the training ground. They asked me to change into the kit that I'd brought with me. Shorts, shirt, socks, boots. Unlike now at Spurs, where you turn up and they give you everything. I was introduced to Bielsa, who said to me, "Go and warm up with the group and join the game. Where do you play?" "Centre back," I answered. "But aren't you a striker?" "Well, in my town I play up front, but I don't like it. I'm a defender." "Okay, that's where you'll play, in defence." The game kicked off, and 5 minutes in, after touching the ball 3 or 4 times, they said to me, "Come off, someone else is coming on." I thought, what is going on here? "Come here, kid. Sit down." Bielsa was next to me, sitting on a ball. "Look, in January we're playing in a tournament in Mar del Plata, and we want you to go with your age group, those born in 72. "Well, I don't know. I have to speak to my parents." "Sure, speak to your parents," Marcelo replied, "and let us know. Now, go and get showered." I'd only played 5 minutes, and I so wanted to keep being involved, even more so at Noor's ground. It's like coming from a small village in rural England and visiting the Tottenham training ground. "No, no, take a shower, and someone will take you to the offices by the stadium." I was taken there, and Grifa was waiting for me. "Okay, son, here is your ticket. Go home and we'll talk. I hope you come with us to play in the tournament. It'd be really great, an experience." That's how it was. I'd gone to Rosario in the morning to be with them, and in the afternoon I was travelling back to my hometown. My parents were happy for me to join Nours for that tournament, so I returned a few days later, and the club treasurer, Vicente Tasca, put me up for a couple of nights. His son was also going to be in the team. I trained with my new colleagues, and we set off for Mar del Plata. We reached the final against Olimpia from Paraguay, and it was all square at 2-2 after 90 minutes. In the second half of extra time, the goalkeeper passed the ball to me on the edge of our area. I kept going and going and going. I exchanged passes with a teammate, and then I went to put a cross in. And it went in. Goal! We won 3-2 and clinched the tournament. We got back to Rosario, and when I got off the coach, Bielsa and Grifa were waiting for me. "So now what? Are you going to stay with us?" "Yes, I'm going to sign." And so I did. I was a racing fan because of my father, but over time I was drawn to Nours. That's the story. Incredible. And interesting. Bielsa needed only 5 minutes. I never asked him what he saw, but I think I understand his thought process. When Jesus Perez, Mickey D'Agostino, or Tony Jimenez and I watch a game now, we see who we need and who we don't. We realize immediately. It's a question of attitude and energy. Do they transmit those traits or not? A guy like Bielsa, who was ahead of his time, just like Grifa, could see the lot in 5 minutes. My career and story would have been completely different if I'd signed for Central. Or, who knows, maybe we'd have made Central as big as Nours. You always have to think big, don't you? Grifa, who was Nours' director of football, became my father figure while I was in Rosario, especially between the ages of 14 and 17. I had a stronger relationship with him than I had with Bielsa, who was initially the reserve team coach. Jose Udica was in charge of the first team when I made my debut as a 17-year-old. Soon after, Marcelo was promoted to first team coach, and we won the league. Under Bielsa, we reached the Copa Libertadores final the following season, but lost to Tele Santana's Sao Paulo on penalties. It was a sensational achievement for a modest team like ours. The philosophy was very similar to the current one at Tottenham. The squad was a mix of young players, like Fernando Gamboa, Eduardo Berizzo, and me, and more experienced heads, such as Tata Martino, Juan Manuel Guillop, and Roberto Scoponi. In that era, players didn't leave Argentina, so it was harder for youngsters like us to get the nod, unless the man in charge was someone like Bielsa, who was just starting out as a coach and hadn't been a top-level player. He had his own ideas about it all. The team's style of play also bore many similarities with Spurs. It was intense, fast-paced with a high press and plenty of mechanical movement. We looked to dominate physically, and our game was about suffocating our opponents, making them uncomfortable when we did not have the ball. We all needed to believe in the coach for it to work. The team was full of players who had responsibilities. We weren't just soldiers. We were all part of the decision-making process. Playing as a left-sided centre-back, I developed under Bielsa, whose audacious and brave philosophy dared to challenge the norm at the time. He was given the nickname Loco, although I never liked it. I know it's a tribute to his different way of thinking, but I consider a move away from common patterns as being exceptional rather than crazy. These days, who has the intellectual ability to see things in a different light? I now understand him better than ever, more so than when I was a footballer. I'd love to sit down with him for some mate and a chat again. Although we do not agree on everything, he was certainly an inspiration when I decided to become a coach. I'm lucky enough to have a wife who understands me and understands football. Karina sometimes complains, and so she must if she thinks we are headed down the wrong path, but she is aware of the fact that football has made me who I am and who we are as a family. It's what we wanted and what we chose to be. The ball has to be our travelling companion. Meeting my wife transformed my life. During a period of change, when everything at Newell's was happening at such a fast pace, she gave me a platform of stability and calmness. In my late teenage years, having won the title, it would have been normal to get caught up in the moment. There were countless sources of temptation, and we Newell's boys felt like we owned the city. In 1993, El Indio Solari was Newell's coach. He was a very special guy, and one day he got us all in for a meeting and said, "Lad, what would you think if we signed Maradona?" Maradona was at Sevilla. I cracked up. Maradona at Newell's, impossible. El Indio responded, "It could be a possibility. What would you think?" "What do you mean, what would we think? If Maradona comes here, we'll die of excitement." El Gringo Justi was involved in the deal alongside fellow well-known agent Toto Rodriguez. The contract was signed 9 months before the 1994 World Cup. El Gringo Justi contacted many of the players, saying, "Here is Diego's number. He'd love you to call him." I was with Karina in my flat on the 13th floor in Cordoba, opposite the National Flag Memorial. But I had my doubts. Should I call him or not? How can I phone Maradona? Bloody hell! I told Karina that when I moved to Rosario as a youngster, I lived in a very small apartment. There was a picture next to the bed, the only one that I had in the whole flat, and it was Maradona in 1986 lifting the World Cup. I always went to sleep with Maradona looking down on me, and now I had to ring him. In the end, I said to myself, "I'll call him." I nervously heard a, "Hello?" "Yes, Diego, it's Mauricio Pochettino. I'm going to be your teammate."
"Poch!"
I almost fainted when he called me Poch.
"How are you doing, Poch?
It's so great to hear from you. I'm very grateful to you for phoning me, with me soon heading over there. I was speechless. Diego arrived in Rosario and had his unveiling the following day. We all went to Newell Stadium to wait for the big moment. There were about 40,000 people there. The ground was full, and it was a dream come true. We looked at him, thinking, no way is Maradona here with us. We didn't have a gym at Newell's, so we went to the one on Cali Mendoza. Maradona would go there in the morning to use the treadmill and boost his strength. He trained very hard, and then he'd join the group in the afternoon. It was a pleasure to train with him. He only wanted to be on the ball. He wasn't about running, he was all about the game. He'd warm up on his own by grabbing a ball before even doing up his laces and kicking it about. It's difficult to explain exactly what he would do, from the noise the ball made when his foot connected with it to his incredible control and the swerve that he could put on it. Afterwards, he'd eat some type of porridge, and he'd go back to the gym on his own in the evening. I was lucky enough to room with him before games. Individual rooms were certainly not the norm. Try telling that to today's players. I didn't sleep for the first few nights. I just looked at him. But after a while, the notion that it was Maradona wore off. He was just my teammate. On one occasion, we were lying on the bed watching football. I don't remember which game it was, but as all players do, we started criticising players. Look at that shot, he's rubbish. One player dribbled past one, then another, but then lost it, and I found myself saying, who does that guy think he is, Maradona? I immediately covered my mouth, but he was already pissing himself with laughter. Remote controls didn't really exist back then. The physio was treating me one afternoon when I was lying on the bed next to Maradona at the Embajador Hotel in Buenos Aires. I can't remember what was on the TV, but at one point we looked at each other as if to say, what the hell is this nonsense? And I unintentionally said to him, Diego, change that rubbish and put something else on. Diego got off the bed and started pressing some buttons on the TV. He suddenly stopped, realised, and said to me, bloody hell, mate, who do you think you are? I'm Maradona. You can change the bloody channel yourself. And he cracked up. I wouldn't say we are friends, but we are fond of each other. I was at his testimonial match on what was a special day in November 2001 at Boca's ground. We all cried when he made his speech. It went like this. I've been waiting. I've been waiting for this game for so long, and it's all over. I hope my love for football and your love for me never waver. I've made mistakes, and I've paid for them. But my love of the ball is still pure. How could we not cry as our idol took his leave? Back in 1991, before Maradona arrived, we headed to Tenerife for a friendly against El Indio Solari's side. We went on to Barcelona and played at Lluís Figueres, where Jorge de Alessandro was in charge. During that tour, I discovered the city of Barcelona, which was gearing up for the Olympic Games. Argentina didn't qualify for the football competition, which was incredible because we had a wonderful team. They called us the Goal and Touch Crew. I fell in love with the city, and when the opportunity to join Espanyol arose, I didn't think twice. I had a chance to go to Boca, or one of a number of clubs in Mexico. The Catalan side's offer was the least financially attractive, and it was the riskiest option, because they'd just clinched promotion. I didn't know much about what was there, but Karina, who was pregnant with Sebastiano, and I chose to head to Barcelona in 1994. That decision had a huge bearing on my career and my life. Grifa, who had played for Espanyol and had become a huge influence on me in my formative years, came with us on that initial trip to Europe, and he was there when I signed the contract with the Catalan club. We played in the UEFA Cup once, and in the Intertoto Cup on a couple of occasions, but in general terms, suffering and enjoyment were served up in equal measure at Espanyol. I remember the last derby at Sarriá Stadium in 1997 before it was demolished. It was an uneven contest. We were in the drop zone, with a new manager and a lengthy injury list, including Tony Jimenez, the current goalkeeping coach at Tottenham. Bobby Robson's Barcelona had to win to keep the pressure on Fabio Capello's Real Madrid, so they started their strongest lineup, including Ronaldo, then FIFA World Player of the Year, and it was my job to mark him. The Brazilian didn't get many touches of the ball. I don't know how I managed it. Well, I did have a plan. I prepared myself mentally. What's the best way to mark Ronaldo? If they pass to him and I give him space to run into, he'll kill me. So what should I do? Not give him space. If he turns, either I foul him or he'll do me. You simply had to anticipate Ronaldo's movement. I did not need my coach to tell me. I know I had to use all of the tools at my disposal, those that I call basic concepts, the things you learn during your football education. A topic that the Spurs coaching group discuss nowadays, and that worries us, is the fact that footballers sometimes lack those basic concepts. We have extraordinary methodology and preparation, so players are well drilled when it comes to tactics, but as for those basic concepts, those things that help you be better on the pitch, not so much. I'm talking about how to take advantage of situations, how to unsettle someone, how to use non-footballing weapons to beat your opponent, how to utilise your intelligence, how to be smart. They're gradually getting lost. They've stopped being transmitted from generation to generation, from old to young. Even coaches have forgotten how to pass down that knowledge. The media also contributes to this bout of collective amnesia. An example would be Toby Alderweireld, who I signed for Tottenham and has been one of the best centre-backs in England over the last 2 years. It makes me laugh the way they pinpoint how he is one of the best because he doesn't commit fouls. A centre-back that doesn't commit fouls. In my time, if you didn't commit fouls, it was because you couldn't play at centre-back. 20 years ago, if you didn't go in hard and mark your territory, strikers would eat you alive. And when you got a yellow card, at least it was after giving someone a good kick. I'd say to the striker, if you're going to get past me, or if you're going to nutmeg me, think twice about it, because I'll kill you. Of course I didn't, but at least he thought that I might. Now the defender who commits the fewest fouls is the best. You've got to be kidding me. How times change. Before Bielsa's arrival at Espanyol was confirmed, I had the chance to move on, but I stayed, as I was very much looking forward to playing under him. Even though he stayed only 6 months before he left to take the reins at the national team, our encounter was crucial for me, as he ended up waking me up from a period of lethargy. I was seemingly asleep, hibernating. He knew the Pochettino from Newell's, but the one he met 6 years later at Espanyol was something else. I was too much in my comfort zone. In fact, I was lost, but I did not know it. We had 3 training sessions during pre-season under Bielsa. The first was from 7:30 a.m, a 45-minute run at the Sant Cugat High Performance Training Centre with inclines and descents. We had heart rate monitors, and they told us how fast we each had to run. We headed back in, showered, had breakfast, relaxed for an hour, and then it was off to the gym for a 90-minute session. We'd shower again and eat lunch, then it was siesta time, and finally training with Bielsa. We didn't see Marcelo during the morning, so he'd come in for the afternoon session, bursting with energy. It was all about tactical work with him. But there were days when we were shattered. We were doing some drills on one of those scorching hot afternoons, and I said to him, Marcelo, calling him by his first name was a bad start, have we got much longer to go? 5 minutes. And we kept working. At the end, a furious Bielsa called me over. Look, that's the last thing I expected from you. It confirms to me just what you've become. He laid into me and I cried. I went home in tears because I felt so embarrassed as I've ever felt in front of someone. Everything he said was right. I'd been blinded, trapped in my own world. I had stopped doing what had got me there in the first place. He helped me to move on, and later called me when he was in charge of the national team. He handed me my full international debut against Netherlands in 1999. If he hadn't gone to Espanyol, I never would have become a senior international. It was a good move not to leave Espanyol in 1999-2000, despite receiving offers from big clubs. Valencia were one of those clubs, but their coach, Héctor Cooper, phoned me to give me a series of explanations which, rather than convincing me to go there, seemed to say, "I don't know if I want you." I feel quite sensitive about these details. I thought, the club makes a written offer, and then the coach tells me he doesn't know if I'm going to play or not, and doesn't show any enthusiasm whatsoever. Interesting. That style of approach taught me a lot. In fact, now I understand it even more. There was also talk of Liverpool, but it felt like England was on another planet back then. I stayed because the club was in a difficult financial position. When I turned Valencia down, I got a call from José Manuel Lara. His family run a publishing house called Planeta, and he was the club's major shareholder. "We know some clubs want you. We aren't doing well financially, but we want to make this a big club, and you're key to that. We want you to finish your career at Espanyol." It was music to my ears. I had a year left on my contract, but they offered me an improved 6-year deal, which I accepted. I signed the pre-agreement, but that document was never presented to the Federation, as it hinged on the agreement between the club, Lara, and Planeta Deportivo, the company linked to the publishing house that wanted to take Espanyol to another level, by buying players and loaning them to the club. That season we won the Copa del Rey final against Atletico Madrid in Valencia, which was a unique achievement after 60 years without a trophy. That victory has possibly greater significance than any of my other accomplishments. After winning the cup, the relationship between Planeta and Espanyol broke down, and I found myself in the middle. I could have asked for the club to honour the new contract that was offered to me, as it had been signed by the president, but it would have put the club in a tight situation, because they could only finance it if Planeta kept helping out, which was no longer the case. So I stayed loyal to the club during the final year of my old contract. So much was written about whether I'd sign a new deal, but in January, an offer came in from Paris Saint-Germain. The club asked me to accept it and leave, which I did. It meant going from Barcelona, a city that I knew well and felt comfortable in, to Paris, where I had to learn a new language and sharpen my senses. I was at PSG when the club signed Ronaldinho, and we had other incredible players like Nicolas Anelka and Mikel Arteta. It all made a huge impact on me. It was a fast-paced bout of personal development. The league was strong, with the likes of Lyon, Marseille, Lille, Girondins de Bordeaux, which were sharing the titles. While at PSG, Bielsa picked me for the 2002 World Cup squad and took me to Japan, although it was a huge disappointment since, despite being favourites, we got knocked out in the group stage. We had Batistuta, Ayala, Zanetti, Veron, Simeone, Aymar, Crespo. We lost 1-0 to England, with David Beckham converting a penalty after I supposedly fouled Michael Owen. He had the ball, I stuck a leg out and he dived. Owen was more Argentinian than me at that very moment. I retired from international football at the age of 30 in 2002, although not for that reason. I wanted to focus on club football. After a year and a half, 70 games and 4 goals for PSG, I moved on to Bordeaux, despite there being an offer from Villarreal on the table. I love wine, and that was part of my thought process. While I was at PSG, I lived in Chambourcy, where the training ground was, on the outskirts of Paris. My landlord worked for the club and was also a salesman for a major winery, so he sent me bottles of champagne and fine wines. Jean-Louis Triot, the Bordeaux president, owned a chateau, and I was able to fulfill my dream of visiting the different wine regions. I believe Bordeaux has the best wine in the world, but it's also a very special region in terms of the energy it gives off. Just 6 months later, in January 2004, I went back to Espanyol. 3 years after leaving. Well, after I was asked to leave. Those 6 months from the day I went back to Espanyol until the final game of the season were among my happiest as a player. It was a real mixed bag. Luis Fernandez had replaced Javier Clemente as coach, with the team rooted to the bottom of the table and 9 points from safety, although there was still half a season left to play. I felt a very intense feeling when I got there. I was welcomed with open arms and was expected to unite a team that was riddled with divisions and problems. I accepted the challenge and was ready for it. That sense of responsibility made me feel important, and the experience will always be with me, as Luis Fernandez allowed me to work very closely with him. He could confide in me, and I was part of the coaching staff's decision-making process. We discussed each and every conundrum, which helped me understand many different aspects of the game. I'm very grateful to him for that. The last match of the campaign was on the horizon. We'd picked up plenty of points and were on the verge of leaving the nightmare prospect of relegation behind. We were at home to John Toshack's Murcia, knowing that victory would guarantee safety. We had a mix of veterans, including the talented Ivan de la Peña, and academy products like Raúl Tamudo and Alberto Lopo. Both youngsters got on the score sheet, and we stayed up. Yes, those were six deeply emotional months. In the summer of 2006, Ernesto Valverde took over at Espanyol and decided that he didn't want me in the squad for the following season, because he felt that I controlled the dressing room. In reality, it was completely the opposite. I defended the previous coach, Miguel Angel Ortina, even in situations when I disagreed with him. There's plenty of proof, and many people know, that I was always loyal to my coaches. In football, there are people who live off confusion, and you sometimes don't know who the good and bad apples are. I talked it over with Valverde. It was hard for me to accept, but I understood over time. When you take over, it's normal to seek out the influential individuals. You ask, and you find out, but you may be given incorrect advice. The truth is, I couldn't have lasted much longer at Espanyol anyway. I'd already given all that I had to give. I thought that I could contribute in the dressing room by calling upon my experience, but Valverde made the right call. I saw him sometime later and said, "Thank you so much for not letting me stay on for another year." If I hadn't been pushed to hang up my boots, I'd still be struggling out on a pitch somewhere today. That's the honest truth. Although, of course, it was hard to take at the time. After almost 300 games over 12 years, including two Copas del Rey, one in 2000 and the one we just won in 2006, I said goodbye to the club at a very emotional press conference. My family was there, including my 12-year-old son, Sebastiano, who was born during my first season at the club. I cried. I think it was because I saw him cry. Or maybe not. I cried because I cried. I had to leave the room for 5 minutes to compose myself. I sometimes get involved in rondos with the players, but I bestow upon myself the privilege of only having to go in the middle to win the ball back when I want to. Come on, if it's a bad pass, the person who played it has to pay for it. I often play in the Football Tennis World Cup finals at the Tottenham training ground. You never completely stop being a footballer, even after you hang up your boots. In 2006, I had offers from Dubai, Qatar, and the United States. A few Spanish teams were also interested, but my family and I needed the stability that we could find in Barcelona. Retiring at 34 gave me the chance to start thinking about my future, prepare for life as a coach, and try to do other things. Having said that, the first thing I did was fly to Argentina, after many years away, for a trip to Bariloche, which I had owed to myself since my teenage years. I wanted to get away from everything. I didn't want to watch television or see photos from training in newspapers. It was really good for me. Almost 2 months later, we returned to Barcelona for the children to go back to school. I received several tributes from friends in Espanol 3.0, a lobby group that wanted to take over the institution, and from the club, including the presentation of a gold and diamond badge before a game against Celta. My friend Pepe Gay, a professor at the private Escuela de Administración de Empresas Business School, recommended a master's degree in sports management, which filled up my mornings from Monday to Friday. A new routine was established, and I didn't mind it one bit. I didn't miss anything. I was happy that year. Very happy. Something clicked in my head. I came out of the bubble that Bielsa had talked about all those years before and changed the way I viewed things. I bought myself a small smart car, which I drove everywhere, and I spent time with people from all over the world. My football career had ended, and I had to open myself to a new working environment. I did keep going to watch Espanyol every other week and forged a great relationship with former coach Javier Azcagorta. I started getting my coaching badges. 3 years after retiring, I was already coaching in the top tier. People say that I started managing Espanyol's women's team, but it's not true. I had to tread carefully because, given my name, if I'd done the hours needed to get my badges with the youth team, the coach would have thought that I was gunning for his job. So we found a solution. Ramon Catara, who was in charge of the Espanyol Academy and had been my fitness coach, invited me to join Emily Montegut, who coached the women, in training during the evenings, and that way Ramon would sign off my placement. So that's what I did. At the start, I went once a week, but the girls asked why I didn't show up more often. I ended up going almost every day. I loved it so much, and even played football with them as a way of keeping fit. Spending the evenings with them was a splendid experience. If I'd been able to instill the passion that those girls had in all the teams I've coached, we'd have won the lot. The boys should watch them closely, see how much they put in and their training conditions, yet they enjoy it so much. The way they compete, how they battle, how they react when a teammate plays a bad pass, how much they want to win, and how united they are. What an example to all. We'd train at 10 p.m. in Sant Andrea in deepest winter, with such little light that you could hardly see anything on the synthetic pitch. That sort of commitment takes something special. I always say to the Spurs players, it's all recorded up here. One day I'll show you the looks on your faces when you go out the door to train, and later I'll show you your faces when you head back to the dressing room. Why don't you make the same face when you get back to the dressing room as when you head out to training? Why not enjoy training? Why don't you love it? Do you only see training as something difficult, an obligation? Do you like football? Or is it just a job for you, or a way to earn money? If the answer to this last question is yes, you can't be the best. It's impossible. When I say that, I often think about those girls. Many people told me that I would be crazy to take over an Espanyol side in crisis, that it would go badly. As a consequence, I would disappear from the map. I was 37, and I'd retired 3 years earlier. When it was offered to me, my head was telling me not to do it, and it'd be difficult to save them. Maybe I didn't have enough experience, but I followed my gut. I said to myself, why not? Halfway through the season in January 2009, the team languished 18th in the table with only 15 points. I was the third coach that campaign, which was the last one at Montjuic. The Cornella El Prat Stadium was set to be completed ahead of the summer, and an inaugural fixture against Rafa Benitez Liverpool was in the offing. But first, we had to stave off relegation. My first game was in the Copa del Rey quarterfinals against Pep Guardiola's Barcelona, with Messi coming off the bench in the second half, yet we held them to a 0-0 stalemate. Not long after in the season, we headed to the Camp Nou in the league as the basement boys, yet we beat them, with Ivan de la Peña bagging a brace. He had never previously scored twice in a game, not even at youth level. We ended up surviving comfortably. We finished 10th on 47 points, thanks to a spectacular second half of the season. We had some decent campaigns. 20 players from the academy were handed their debuts during my tenure. I had a showdown with club legend Raul Tamudo. I made mistakes. We won, we lost, and I learned from every second of it. Those 5 seasons allowed me to develop into a coach that championed a particular style of play, and did so at a club that we all at home loved. In the midst of all that, on my watch, our captain, Danny Hake, passed away, aged 26. The blow to the club is still being felt. The decision to come to England had plenty to do with my wife and Jesus Perez, who had already become my assistant at Espanyol. Of course, I'll always be grateful to Nicola Cortesi, the Southampton chairman, for having the courage to bring me in. But in truth, I did not want to join. Why? First of all, because I didn't know a word of English, and second, because I'd left Espanyol in November and planned to get my head in order and start studying English from January until June. I even had a teacher lined up. I wanted to devote weekends to the family and then be fresh to take on another challenge in 5 or 6 months' time. I'd watch my son play football at the weekend. I'd take my wife out for dinner on Saturday evenings. We'd go to watch a film on Sundays. I'd watch live football. It would have been the perfect world. But suddenly, after finishing one day, I was offered the possibility of going at it again. My head was about to explode. This is how we made the decision. I was with Jesus and my wife discussing whether we should say yes or no. It all felt overwhelming for a moment, and I said, I wouldn't go to England, that's it, goodbye. I went to the bathroom downstairs, and silence descended upon the house. I wasn't scared. I respect everything and everyone, but I don't fear anything. My 4 years at Espanyol had been so tough, and I thought, where do I have to go? Southampton? Where's that? In England? No bloody way. We'd started tracking all the major leagues and gathering information, but, as I said, I'd already planned the following 6 months in my head. I went back into the lounge, and both of them were staring at me. My wife said, you have to go. I looked at Jesus, and he said, I agree, we have to go. Of course, he wanted to go because he spoke English. I thought, what can I say to a player when I do not understand a word of what is said to me? Jesus insisted, it's an opportunity for you. My wife agreed. I don't know why she had that vision, but she said that England was a good place for me. At that moment, I decided to accept the offer. From then on, of course, I started watching game after game. I immersed myself in Southampton, the other teams, the whole Premier League, and all the rest. I don't know if 2 weeks' rest is long enough after a grueling Premier League season. It's an unknown. To put it another way, holidays are never long enough. It happens to all of us. When you have a perfect week, you want another one. If you have a month off, you'll certainly want another one. In my 17-year playing career, I always said, the day when I stop playing football will be the day when I enjoy my holidays again. I'll have unlimited holidays. Pah. It's hard to do that, isn't it? When you don't know what's happening with your future, those holidays feel very different compared with when you know you have a fixed target ahead of you. When you don't know if you're going to work, if you're going to find a team, holidays stop being that coveted source of relaxation. I am lucky I work at Spurs, a top club, but it's been a confusing summer with mixed emotions. We start pre-season tomorrow. My blood still boils when I think about the Newcastle game. We need to keep looking for the reasons. Of course, what we achieved and the way we did it didn't go unnoticed. Big European clubs have been looking for and interviewing prospective new coaches. They want excitement and hard work, not to mention success, as soon as possible. One of them rang me, one that wants to change things and win the lot. They got in touch on several occasions, but it isn't time to change. Pep Guardiola is coming to the Premier League with Manchester City. Jose Mourinho is taking over at Old Trafford. Antonio Conte is going to Chelsea. We'll have to perform really well to be at their level. But we can do it. On Friday the 1st of July, Jesus, Tony and Mickey, Miguel D'Agostino, a former teammate of mine from Newell's days, started working with the players who weren't on international duty, and also with a group of youngsters who, at the end of last season, we decided would be given a chance to train with the first team. My team and I love helping young players. It's like planting a tree, watering it and watching it grow. All the fruit that it bears comes from the land and environment that you put in place. There's nothing quite like winning with the team you joined at 13 or 14 and have given your heart and soul to. You then move on to play for the first team with a feeling of identity that offers the team an added extra. It's something that will be stamped on every side I coach. It was instilled in my genes during my time at Newell's. It's what Grifa and Bielsa taught me. In any case, moving up is not an automatic process. Over a 3, 4, 5, or 6 month period, the players with potential train with the first team until they are ready. We don't just play footballers from the under 21 straight away. As with everything, there is a process of adapting to training and gaining acceptance. The first team players need to feel that the youngster is part of the group, so his time comes when a majority endorse him, with both sporting and personal recognition. Today, Monday the 4th of July, I joined up with the squad. We worked on improving the squad early on, even before last spring. It's the chairman who takes the final steps when it comes to transfers, especially with regard to financial decisions, and we do have our limits in that field. We're kicking off pre-season feeling calm, as we've sealed two signings that will boost the squad. Victor Wanyama from Southampton.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.